Hi everyone, welcome back to Redox lesson part 2. In this video, you will be learning about oxidizing agents, reducing agents, experiments and the titration calculations. First, we have a look at a simple redox reaction in order to understand what is an oxidizing agent, what is a reducing agent and what changes would take place in oxidizing agents and the reducing agents during the course of reaction. Here we have copper oxide reacts with zinc, give you zinc oxide and copper. You can clearly see copper oxide has lost oxygen, therefore it has undergone reduction. We can explain that using oxidation numbers as well. The oxidation number of copper is +2 and the oxidation number of copper here is 0. So the oxidation number has reduced. Not only that, the 2 plus ion has taken 2 electrons from zinc to become 0. Let's have a look at zinc. Zinc, of course, it is 0 in the reactant side. It is +2 in the product side. So it has gained oxygen. So it's oxidation. It has increased the oxidation number. So it is oxidation. In order to become positively charged, it has to lose electrons. As a result, it's an oxidation. So it's a summary about the redox reactions we learned in the last lesson. The definition of an oxidizing agent, in simple terms, that is the reactant which will oxidize the other reactant. The reducing agent is the reactant which makes the other reactant to undergo reduction. What does it mean? The oxidizing agent has to undergo reduction, whereas the reducing agent has to undergo oxidation. Let's try to understand what is the oxidizing agent and the reducing agent using this example. Copper oxide undergoes reduction, which will make zinc to undergo oxidation. Therefore, we call copper oxide is the oxidizing agent. In order to make the other reactant to get oxidized, itself has to undergo reduction, which means the oxidizing agent is the reactant, which means oxidizing agent is going to lose oxygen atoms and it is going to reduce its oxidation state and it is going to accept electrons. So an oxidizing agent which is going to oxidize the other reactant should undergo reduction, which means it should undergo loss of oxygen and it has to reduce its oxidation state and it has to gain electrons. Zinc is the reactant which undergoes oxidation in this example, which means it is the reactant which makes the other reactant to reduce. Therefore, zinc is the reducing agent. So what will happen to zinc during the course of reaction? It has to gain oxygen. You also learned its oxidation state is increasing. You also can clearly understand that it is going to remove electrons in order to become positively charged. So what can we tell about the reducing agent? The reducing agent is the substance or the reactant which is going to reduce the other reactant by gaining oxygen or increasing oxidation state or by removing electrons. From this example, we can understand a redox reaction must have both oxidizing agent and a reducing agent. In the laboratory, we have some common oxidizing agents and reducing agents in order to do experiments. Both in qualitative and quantitative analysis, we use non-oxidizing agents and reducing agents. Let's have a look at what are these oxidizing agents, reducing agents and their applications. The most used oxidizing agent in the laboratory experiments and also in industrial applications is potassium manganate 7. The common name is potassium permanganate. Potassium permanganate is a strong oxidizing agent in both acidic and alkaline media. Potassium permanganate has an intense violet color even at low concentrations such as 0.02 moles per dm cube. It is used both in qualitative and quantitative analysis of reducing agents. We can see a clear color change from violet to almost colorless solution from KMnO4 experiments, unless there is no other colored compound in the solution. We'll see why. MnO4-, which is the active ion as an oxidizing agent, will undergo reduction by accepting 5 electrons, producing Mn2+ ions, which is almost colorless. It's a characteristic observation that the violet color of the solution changes to colorless or almost colorless. Potassium permanganate can oxidize a variety of inorganic and organic compounds. Therefore, it is used heavily in both qualitative and quantitative analysis. This is the potassium permanganate solution, which has intense violet color. What we do first, we fill potassium permanganate into the burette. We have to fill the burette up to the zero level for this titration when we do it first time. Now we are going to make this zero. It is sometimes difficult to see the meniscus. If the concentration is too high, in that situation we'll be keeping a lit candle behind the meniscus so that you can see the meniscus. But this situation I can clearly see meniscus touching the zero mark. This is aqueous Fe2+ solution which will be titrated by KMnO4. I am going to measure 25 cm cube of this solution accurately using the pipette. We have to take the solution little above the mark and then take the meniscus back to the mark carefully. Now I transfer that solution into the conical flask. The conical flask held slant and the pipette should be vertical. This is diluted sulfuric acid which should be added to the mixture to make it acidic enough, because the reaction happens in an acidic medium. You remember that the reaction requires 8 moles of H+ ions for 1 mole of manganate ion. So I am going to acidify the solution. We are going to titrate this solution, Fe2+ solution, with KMnO4. You can see the violet color of KMnO4 disappears upon reacting with Fe2+ solution. The solution is slightly getting brownish due to the formation of Fe3+. Now it's very close to the end point, you can see. So we got the end point of the titration, you can see. This is the end point color of the solution, where a drop of KMnO4 is remaining. This shows all Fe2+ ions have reacted. In the previous demonstration of the titration, you learned how to use KMnO4 to titrate a reducing agent with unknown concentration. And let's see how can we use the data obtained in the titration experiment to find the concentration of the reducing agent. We reacted Fe2+ with KMnO4. The volume of Fe2+ solution we used was 25.0 cm cube, and the concentration of KMnO4 used was 0.02. Let's assume the average volume we obtain in the titration is 15.00. So what do we know currently? We know the concentration of KMnO4 and the volume of KMnO4, which means we can find the moles of KMnO4. First, we need to get the balanced ionic equation for the overall reaction. Fe2+ is going to get oxidized to Fe3+. During this titration. So you can see we have 5 electrons gained by manganate ion and only 1 electron released by Fe2+ ion. So we need to multiply the second reaction by 5 and then add to the first reaction. So what you end up with here is manganate ion 8H+ and 5 Fe2+. will be reacting to give respective products. From the balanced ionic equation, we can find out the stoichiometry between manganate ion and Fe2 plus ion. The stoichiometry between these two ions will be 1:5 according to the balance equation. What is the set of data available for us to do the calculation? We have KMnO4 concentration, average volume of KMnO4 spent in the titration. So we can find the moles of KMnO4. Moles of Fe2 plus can be calculated using the moles of KMnO4 and using the ratio. So according to the ratio 1:5, you need to get 3×10⁻⁴ into 5 moles of Fe2 plus. Once we have found the moles of Fe2 plus in 25 cm cube of this solution, we can do the rest of the calculation. We can find the concentration. You can find the moles of Fe2 plus which was in the solid, which was dissolved to make this solution. Likewise, you can do the further calculation. This shows the basic calculation including the molar ratio in this reaction. Potassium permanganate can be used to quantify many other reducing agents. For example, hydrogen peroxide, sulfide ions, ethandioate ions, which you can try writing the balanced ionic equation after this. Potassium permanganate can be used to quantify oxidizing agents as well. Not because potassium permanganate is reacting with the particular oxidizing agent, but we can use the back titration concept. So what is the back titration concept? Unlike direct quantifying using KMnO4, the oxidizing agent that we want to find out the concentration of will be reacted with known excess amount of Fe2 plus ions. After that, we can titrate the remaining Fe2 plus ions. Let's see a situation like this. X4 plus is an oxidizing agent which is going to undergo reduction readily. We need to find the concentration of X4 plus in the solution. So you know KMnO4 is also an oxidizing agent which is not going to react with directly. So what we do here, we are going to make X4 plus ion to react with Fe2 plus. We take an accurately measured amount of Fe2 plus ions. The concentration is known, the volume is known. For that, we will be adding an accurately known volume of X4 plus solution. The idea is to make it to react with Fe2 plus, provided that Fe2 plus is kept in excess. The resulting mixture will have excess Fe2 plus, which will eventually titrate with KMnO4 solution. Suppose the average endpoint of the titration is 12.5. Now I'm going to explain you how to calculate the concentration of X4 plus solutions stepwise. So the first thing we are going to do, step 1, is to find the moles of KMnO4. So we found the moles of KMnO4 using the titration. Now we can use the ratio between manganate ion and the Fe2 plus ion to find the remaining moles of Fe2 plus in the original mixture. We are using the ratio between MnO4 minus ion and Fe2 plus, which is 1:5. Now what do we know? We know the remaining Fe2 plus. So what we can do is to find the original moles of Fe2 plus, so we know the initial number of moles of Fe2 plus and we know the remaining number of moles of Fe2 plus. Now we'll find the number of moles of Fe2 plus reacted with X4 plus. Here we have the initial number of moles of Fe2 plus added. Here is the Fe2 plus remain after reacting with X4 plus? It was titrated and found. So what you get here is 1.25 into 10 to the power minus 3 moles. Next, we have to use the ratio between Fe2 plus and X4 plus. You can clearly see it's 1:2. So you can find the X4 plus moles by taking the Fe2 plus moles and dividing it by 2. So we get X4 plus moles 6.25 into 10 to the power minus 4. Once we have found the moles of X4 plus, we can find its concentration, or we can convert these moles into mass, or whatever the parameter asked in the question. Ionometry is another quantitative analysis method used in redox titrations. An aqueous solution of iodine is titrated with sodium thiosulfate solution in this redox titration. This is the aqueous iodine solution that we need to find the concentration. I'm going to measure 25 cm³ of that. It will be transferred into the conical flask. Special thing about this titration is that the indicator is not added at the beginning. We need to add thiosulfate solution drop by drop until the brown color goes pale yellow. You added starch, now it is blue black in color. The titration can be carried out further. At the end point, it goes colorless from blue black. You can see the solution has gone colorless. We added starch at the end when it is very close to the end point, when the solution is pale yellow. Let's see by accidentally if you add starch at the beginning. You can clearly see the solution has some insoluble black or blue black solid. When it is there, it's difficult to titrate and get proper colorless solution. Starch added will form blue black insoluble complex with iodine, which will not release iodine back to the titration. Then titration result going to be wrong. I'm going to explain you how to do the calculations related to this titration. 25 cm³ of iodine solution is put into the conical flask. The expected color change is going to be blue black to colorless because the starch added is making a complex with iodine which has the color of blue black. And once all iodine is over after the reaction with thiosulfate, the solution will become blue black to colorless because there is no more iodine available to bind with starch to give you blue black complex. Here is the reaction. In this reaction, iodine undergoes reduction because zero oxidation state goes to -1. And thiosulfate ion will undergo oxidation because the average oxidation state of sulfur increases from +2 to +2.5. Suppose the average endpoint volume we obtain from our titration is 20 cm³. First we find the moles of sodium thiosulfate. Now we need to find the moles of iodine. For that we are going to use the ratio. When you know the moles of iodine present in 25 cm³, then you can find the concentrations, mass, or any other parameter related to the analysis. Ionometry is one of the most widely used redox titration, both in school laboratories and even in the industries. But how? You are only analyzing iodine there. Ionometry can be used to quantify both oxidizing agents and reducing agents. When you want to quantify an oxidizing agent, you have to add an excess of iodide ions into the oxidizing agent. That will produce iodine, which you can analyze using ionometry, so that you can find out how much oxidizing agent was there. If you want to quantify a reducing agent, you are add a known excess amount of iodine into the reducing agent so that the reducing agent will react with some amount of iodine which will become iodide ions. The remaining iodine can be titrated with sodium thiosulfate and 5 moles of remaining iodine. You know the amount of iodine you added and now you know the remaining iodine you have. Subtracting the two values, then you can find the number of moles of iodine needed to react with the reducing agent. Using the stoichiometry, you can find the amount of reducing agent. So iodine can be used to quantify both oxidizing agents and the reducing agents. Next few minutes, you will find out some calculations related to iodometry.
Potassium iodate 5 is an oxidizing agent. You add excess of potassium iodide into potassium iodate 5 to produce an amount of iodine which depends only on the amount of potassium iodate 5. After that, this iodine solution has to be titrated, but only 25 cm cube portion of this solution is subjected to titrate. First, calculate the number of moles of sodium thiosulfate used in the titration, which is 0.00216 moles. Then use the equation of the titration where the molar ratio between thiosulfate and iodine is 2:1. Therefore, the moles of iodine can be calculated. It is 0.00108. The iodine produced can be used to calculate the amount of iodate ions present in the original solution. For that, you need to use the balanced ionic equation. In the equation, you can see the ratio between iodate ion and iodine is 1:3. Therefore, you can divide the number of moles of iodine by 3 to find the moles of iodate ion. But the sample we titrated was 25.0 cm cube. Therefore, the number of moles you calculated should be scaled up to 250 cm cube solution. As a result, it will be multiplied by 10, then the answer is 0.0036 moles of iodate were present. And the moles of iodate is going to be equal to the moles of potassium iodate, so that we can find the mass by multiplying the moles using the molar mass. And the mass can be divided by the mass of the solid used at the beginning to find the percentage purity.
Now we have come to the end of the redox lesson. We started from oxidation numbers and we went for the half ionic equation balancing overall ionic equations, oxidizing agents and reducing agents, and the redox titration, some practical aspects also. And finally we came to iodometry as one of the most widely used redox titration. Hope you have enjoyed this video and understood the lesson well. Thank you.